But I think we should let's do some more Lula, because I need a little bit of inspiration. We have some clips, and we can get into a little bit more. Again, we're going to do a really next week's episode is going to be dedicated to that. You know, if you sort of scroll forward a little bit, Matt, to like when he actually gives a speech, I think that would be great. Around, you'll find it. But you know, again, like Lula has had these charges dropped, as I was hinting at earlier. You know, there are some questions about the political calculus of Judge Fachin in pulling back these charges against Lula, that it might be, you know, to protect people like Moro. But again, it is a reality of like the political calculus changing because so many people were organizing and fighting against this. Lula is certainly fired up. And we'll talk a little bit about the speech that he made after we watched this clip. But I just wanted to put this clip on, one, to celebrate a little bit and just to remember what this felt like when things seemed so dark in Brazil with the rise of Bolsonaro and Lula turning himself in. So this is the day before Lula surrendered himself to be imprisoned for crimes that he did not commit in a extremely ridiculous trial against him that was fueled by the United States, the FBI, and the CIA. And that's not just me alleging it at this point. We have material evidence of that. In fact, way more material evidence than they were ever able to.
Yeah, funny you should mention material Lula. Evidence.
But anyways, we should play this because it's a really great, speech that Lula gives here.
Não adiantam tentar evitar que eu ande por esse país, porque tem milhões e milhões de Lula, de Bolo, de Manuela, de Dilma Rousseff para andar por mim. Não adianta tentar acabar, sabe, com as minhas ideias. Elas já estão pairando no ar e não tem como prendê-las. Não adianta tentar parar o meu sonho, porque quando eu parar de sonhar, eu sonharei pela cabeça de vocês e pelos olhos de vocês. Não adianta achar que tudo vai parar o dia que o Lula tiver infarte. É bobagem, porque o meu coração baterá pelo coração de vocês. E são milhões de corações. Os poderosos podem matar uma, duas ou três rosas, mas jamais conseguirão deter a chegada da primavera. E a nossa luta é em busca da primavera.
Yeah, man. I mean, it's just something else. It brings a little bit of chills, obviously, for us personally too. Right. It was, you know, that fight was so important to the work that we had been doing. And I think we'll spend a little bit of time in the post game, maybe watching Michael's interview with Lula, because that was a really special moment. But one thing that I think is very interesting about like the Lula that we're seeing now is that he is very much fired up. I think it's seemingly very clear that he is going to run in 2022. And one thing that Michael had said to me a couple of times privately was that, you know, Lula had been able to spend so much time when he was in prison, like reading and theorizing, because he didn't have to be so engaged, like on the streets and stuff like that, that he was sort of coming out with not just like a lot of, like physical energy, frankly, but also like a very strong theoretical and political energy, which I'm really excited to see how that develops.
Yeah, it's interesting. So far, I mean, we talked about his speech. He emphasized Bolsonaro's catastrophic handling of COVID. It will be, and a lot of the analysts I saw say he's striking a moderate tone. And it's interesting in, watching The Edge of Democracy, and we'll watch some clips of that in the post game. But there's a whole group of people that are yelling, saying, and they're not like left or right. They're saying no parties, like get out of our face, like about any kind of party because of the amount of polarization that has gone on in Brazil. And I think like it's interesting strategically how Bolsonaro is, because there's also who knows if there's going to be more lawfare. Hopefully not. Hopefully, like, Moro is like the end of it. I don't know. I'm glad to hear that part of it. I hadn't heard that, his sort of theoretical time.
But I mean, even the way that his interviews, you know, when he was let out, like, he started to become a lot more pugnacious with talking about U.S. involvement. You know, one of the first things he did recently, earlier this week, was, you know, thank, you know, Maduro for his support and proclaim that he, you know, stands fervently against United States involvement in Venezuela, in Ecuador, in Bolivia, in Cuba, right? He's very much aligning himself with the global left movements, right? And I think it's an important thing. Not that Lula wasn't aware of the great danger to the North, but that, you know, he tried to have like a conciliatory relationship with like global finance and global capital. They really thought that they were going to, you know, if they didn't push too hard, you know, and completely shift the economy into like a full on, you know, socialist, you know, vision, that they would be able to implement the really critical reforms that were needed in Brazil. And what we've seen now, after, you know, seeing the end of Lava Jato and the lawfare against Lula, is that even that kind of very, very conciliatory approach, the United States will still work against you and treat you as a threat. You know, and that's structural. I will also say that there is a personal thing. And it's another thing that Mike would always mention, that Obama was extremely jealous of Lula. You know, when he calls him the most popular politician in the world, I don't think that was all coming from admiration as much as a little bit of anger that he wasn't the one who was considered to be that globally.
Also, like, you compare like what they were doing like decades ago, and Lula is way more, like, Obama, Harvard Law. I mean, good luck. No. Lula's in the streets with, you know, up against dictatorship. That's the other thing about, you know, the end of democracy as a title is, you realize like how recent that is in a lot of places. I mean, people should realize that we're barely even in America too, but like literally military rule of the country. And you have people that go into the streets saying, bring the generals, where are you? Come back. Because like that, it's like a third party. The third party in Brazil is the generals come back to fix everything.
You know, exactly. And again, next week, we're going to do a really in-depth interview with Victor, you know, who was formerly at The Intercept, and they did such an incredible job of exposing the fraud that was Lava Jato. Also, of course, want to shout out Brian Muir and Brazil Wire. And there's a couple of last points I wanted to make before we move on from this. One, I wanted to read this section from Brian Muir's piece in Brazil Wire. Let me see. I can pass it over to you just if you wanted to show it. Just the title for everybody. Oh, it's probably not going to work. But it's a piece in Brazil Wire called Lava Jato Dies, Lula is Reborn, Behind the Supreme Court Ruling, where Brian Muir just does a great job recapping you know, what's happened over the past few years. And this is a section from it that I think, you know, really hits home. After all, none of the charges against Lula had any material evidence. They were all based on coerced plea bargain testimonies by jailed businessmen who, in every case, changed their stories multiple times before receiving partial illicit asset retention, greatly reduced sentences, and transfer to house arrest. In the triplex apartment case, Moro was forced to sentence Lula for indeterminate acts of corruption. Let me read that again to y'all. Moro was forced to sentence Lula for indeterminate acts of corruption because no material evidence was ever produced showing that Lula owned or slept in the apartment or that the alleged illegal reforms had taken place. Furthermore, prosecutors were unable to establish any quid pro quo because the alleged benefits took place years after Lula had left office. And I just want people to remember how ridiculous these charges were And for folks who aren't familiar, because, you know, you hear Lava Jato and it's the corruption, what they, the only thing that they were able to like try to pin on him, and they weren't able to prove it at all, was this theory that maybe Lula got some bathroom renovations on an apartment for cheap, right? Still paid for them, but just like for like, you know, significantly less, as, you know, a kind of bribe to him. Again, no actual evidence of this, no real connection, but that's as close as they got to anything against Lula. Of course, it was nonsensical. It was a part of their strategy to just throw anything against him and hope that there would be enough media frenzy that they would be able to either prevent him from running a successful campaign, or what they ended up being successful with was prevent him from actually running for office at all. I bring this up because we talked a lot about Lula over these past few years for a couple different reasons. One, because he's a very important figure on the global left, and because of, you know, his political strategy and what he has done for Brazil, right? And we'll talk a little bit more about that next week. But it also really highlights something that was critical to the work of TMBS, which was trying to encourage us to think politically and strategically and materially about politics, and not to get distracted by symbolism or abstractions, right? What do I mean by that? The symbolism against Lula was anti-corruption politics, right? And it was just like what we were talking about with Matt Karp earlier in this episode, where like you start to say like, oh, this is a campaign against corruption, and like everyone's brains start to turn off, right? Because they're like, oh, well, corruption is bad. Oh, and this is going through the court, so those must be neutral arbiters of this question, right? And they were successful in this because so many people, one, were willing in Brazil. The ruling class hated Lula. As you know, Lula said that one time that, you know, they hated him so much because he had, somebody told him once that they hated him because he turned the airports into a bus station. Basically, what he means, you know, what he means by that is that because people's standards of living increased, that they did not want to be seeing other members of their country in these, you know, elitist areas, right?
I mean, that's, like, I think that example is so important, because I think that is in the wild and sort of pre-partisan, the counter-revolutionary sort of sentiment, yeah, in people. And like, to extent that people have that sort of reaction, they're an enemy until they remedy it, basically.
Mm-hmm. No, exactly. And yeah, it's exactly what you're saying there. And like, so, you know, that was like a big part of the motivation for his opponents. And honestly, we should talk more about what happened in the United States and in the United Kingdom, where you had all of these idiots take that bait, hook, line, and sinker, right? Where they started to say, oh, wow, you know, I want a Lava Jato t-shirt, right? Like, that they thought that these like anti-corruption politics were legitimate when they clearly weren't. And all you need to do was to start to look at the class forces and do that kind of serious analysis to see that something was up there. Right. So, you know, remember that, understand that this trial, just like any kind of major political event, these things are never going to be neutral. And you need to just erase that concept from your head if you want to do serious political analysis. Right. All of these decisions have a motivation behind them. Right. As to what is possible under the current conditions. The conditions then allowed them to imprison Lula. The conditions now do not. Right? It's the same law, right? It's the same, you know, judges, the same figures. They're changing the, you know, they're changing the ruling now because they have changed political calculus. And you need to understand this, because that is how they play you. Lava Jato was designed to tank Lula because the right wing knew they couldn't beat him. They didn't intend for Bolsonaro to come into the chaos, but they were happy with him to be the sledgehammer to destroy the project of Lula da Silva and the Workers' Party. Right. So this is a victory for Brazil and for poor and working people. But you need to understand that this is not limited to Brazil. Right. It's, you know, they understand that if they can turn politics away from actual class analysis and material policy analysis, things like that, into these kind of like notions of like impartiality and like neutrality, that they can achieve a lot. What do I mean by that? In Brazil, it was the accusations of corruption against Lula and Lawfare, right? In Bolivia, it was the same thing when they said that Evo Morales was tampering with the votes, right? And a lot of people, a lot of the same people who are condemning Lula were very quick to accept completely fraudulent accusations about Evo Morales that led to a right-wing coup against him, right? The stakes are high. Don't be sloppy. Don't let these people get away with it. We're seeing another chapter of this right now with what the seemingly character who has grown in some kind of like progressive, like lab grown area to appeal to like American, you know, left wingers. I'm talking about Yaku Perez, and we'll get to him in the post game too. And I've got to say this again, you know, who is now somebody, you know, all these people in the United States were, you know, going on about like, oh, wow, this is so great. We have like this eco-socialist who's running, and it's like, oh, wow, what an incredible moment. You have the traditional left versus like this kind of new, more granola left, right? And it stunk to high heaven then. And now we're seeing very clearly what his end game is, which is to delegitimize a legitimate election in Ecuador. He's now calling for the military and the police to take action against the fraudulent election in Ecuador. Again, no credible evidence of any kind of fraud.
Is he saying anything about Jovenel Moise? I mean, not that he could be expected to, but just to talk about that double standard, you know, if it was like a Maduro term gets an extension gets viewed a lot differently by, for instance, the OAS than Jovenel Moise, it's like, all right, let's just roll with Moise for whatever. There's some problems, but he's cool with the IMF, so, you know, let's roll with them.
No, I mean, and like, you know, remember Perez was somebody who celebrated Evo Morales's ouster. He was somebody who celebrated Lula's imprisonment, right?
Which, we I all, mean, you know, how is, yeah, it's just, it, that, to me, like, that's a good enough, that's enough.
Yeah, for sure. It's enough evidence there, but it just don't be sloppy because they know how to play you, right? And anyways, I'll end up, you know, on that note, but just like, no, the FBI and the CIA were involved in Lava Jato. They know how to play to an international audience. They know how to tell these stories, and they know what works. Be very, you know, be serious, be structural in your analysis. Don't let yourself get caught up in these, cinematic narratives, because they certainly are written. If that is the case, right? If it just seems so like, oh, wow, this is like a movie, all the big bad guys are going down because that we finally have good justice system in Brazil, and, they're going to take them down, and, you know, the corrupt guys are going to go away, and there's going to be peace and prosperity.
And then the system can actually get back to, you know, delivering for the people.
Yeah, like it did before Lula was in power, right? I don't know. It's just like, be serious, be prepared for this, because they know that they try this playbook everywhere. And it's just like, it's very important to be, you know, not suspicious, not conspiratorial about anything, but to sit here and say, huh, I wonder who would want to take Lula out. I wonder, you know, what kind of like class interests there are in destroying one of the most popular left-wing candidates in the globe on charges that he got some construction work done on an apartment in a beach town, but is also not even one of the most popular beach towns in Brazil, right? Like, you should sit there and say to yourself, like, okay, something's a little bit fishy here, instead of just sprinting into support of these things. And if you don't know, spend a little bit of time in research before you shoot your mouth off, especially if you're a journalist, I will say. That was the thing. Like, The Guardian completely debased itself, when it came to Lava Jato.
I mean, The Guardian, I remember in, like, high school, college, that was, like, the left-wing paper I would check on. I was, like, too, I guess, snooty for HuffPo. So I learned to go to The Guardian, and on a number of issues, from that to, you know, the Corbyn stuff, what's going on? What's going on at the Manchester Guardian?
Yeah, man.
The history behind that paper.
I just want to, as a like a little bow on this, I want to just read from Lula's most recent speech. I mean, this is why he's a good political communicator, and I just want to highlight this message again. He's fighting against, you know, one of the most, probably only second to the United States, horrible COVID responses. And, he's definitely going to make that a big part of, you know, his, if he runs, but I think he definitely will, presidential bid. But he had this great line, and this is the Lula skill, I think, just like putting things very clearly, where he said, you know, when it comes to funding for vaccines and distribution, vaccines aren't about whether you have the money or not. They're about whether you love life or love death. And that's the Lula gift, to really be able to put things extremely clearly like that. And it certainly is that question in Brazil.
Absolutely. Lula Livre.
Lula Livre, baby.